Well, today is a great day. It's a day to rejoice, and it's a day of divine appointments. If you have been around and you're aware, we had a plan for today to have Pastor Jack and his wife Trish Grebleski with us from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. They were unable to be here because of the storms that came through earlier in the week. Their flights were canceled. They couldn't get out of the airport flying from Newark, New Jersey here until like later today. And they had planned to come on Wednesday. That's how bad things were messed up. So as a result, we have a brand new opportunity of having Pastor Louis Kotze from Hatfield Christian Center in Pretoria, South Africa, to be with us today. Now, I'm going to introduce him in just a moment, but let me just take a moment and put all of this into context of what I believe God has done, okay? Pastor Jack and Trish are going to be with us at some other weekend this year. We're going to work out another time for them to come and to be able to share with us. But everybody does know, we've been saying it, it's Palm Sunday, right? So I just want to read something that Jesus did on Palm Sunday as he entered into the city of Jerusalem. It's found in Luke chapter 19, beginning with verse 41. And I believe this is a statement for us today, and I believe a significant day for our city, for Fort Worth, for Azle. Says that it now, as he, talking about Jesus, drew near, he saw the city and he wept over it, saying, if you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace. And then he chides him, he says, but now they are hidden from your eyes. And he prophesies what's going to happen 70 years or 40 years later in the year 70 AD of the destruction of Jerusalem when the Roman armies come in and surround it and destroy Jerusalem and the temple. And they level it to the ground. And then he says this. He ends in the second half of verse 44. He says, because you did not know the time of your visitation. The God who created the heavens and the earth was walking into their presence, and they didn't recognize. They didn't recognize him, and they didn't recognize the moment that God had preordained for him to be there. And as a result, they missed not only that moment, they missed their future. They missed more than an opportunity. Their lack of discernment cause them just to go through life in the natural. You following what I'm saying? I believe that today is a divine appointment. I believe it's a day of divine appointment for us personally, for us as a church, and for us as a city. This is not to put pressure. This is to say, I believe that God has sent this moment and a man of God from Pretoria, South Africa, that by his presence, he carries a mission, he carries a purpose, he carries an unction from God for the church in this hour. And I believe God is sending to us today to leave a deposit spiritually, to do more than speak words, but to impart a presence and a sense of mission and purpose for our city. I believe that this moment is bigger than us. This moment is a visitation from God for us. And that our faith not only can, but should engage with it. Can you be in agreement with me? Pastor Louis Kotze leads Hatfield Christian Center, which is a phenomenal church in Pretoria, has two campuses. He leads both campuses currently. He was a pastor at the South Campus about 1200 when they went through a leadership change at the other campus, North Campus, East Campus. And he was ultimately invited to come and be the leader of both campuses, which all together is somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 to 12,000 people, thereabouts, and have cell groups and homes throughout the city, has huge influence into every market, every area, government, education, tremendous strength of a local church that's been there since the early 70s, influencing and changing that city, that area, and the nation. And today, we get to hear from Pastor Louis Cote, and I believe there is a kingdom partnership that's taking place to advance the kingdom. Would you give him a warm welcome here at the Abbey as he comes to share the word? His son Ethan is with him on this trip. Awesome. And I'm going to ask you, while you're standing, if you would just stretch out your hands towards him and let's engage our faith to receive. Heavenly Father, thank you that you've put us in divine partnership for your purpose. Lord, we can enjoy relationship, but your relationship always carries purpose beyond just our mutual enjoyment. So, Lord, we pray for Pastor Louis today, and we receive his gift, and we receive the word that you've placed in his heart for us today. We receive your anointing through him, and we believe for greater things to be done in our city, for greater things to be done in our lives, for greater things to be released in our midst by divine partnership. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Louis.
I have the tradition back home to say when I get to the pulpit to say, good morning, family. Is that okay if I say it here today also with you? Good morning, family.
Good morning.
It's so good to be with you. It really feels like home. And I when I knew I was coming in this part of the world, I sent Pastor Paul and Perianne a message and said, I just want to come and see the Abbey and heard, you know, have been here before, but heard, haven't been here to Azel yet, and just wanted to come and visit. So we had plans that yesterday I was going to come and just spend time here and come and see your place. And I know you redid things and are still busy with construction, and just to come and celebrate. And on Friday morning, I was just brushing my teeth, and the Lord said to me, you need to get ready to speak. And okay, whatever. There was nothing, I sort of thought it was me, and wasn't really prepared. And then when I got to our meeting, they said, oh, wouldn't, you know, so it's such an honor to be here, and I was really looking forward to just being with you, and being able to share with you is a real privilege. I know that you think I have an accent, but I don't. It's you all that have an accent, or I should say y'all that have an accent. So if you struggle with my way of speaking, just put up your hand. I'll try and speak a bit slower or anything. And it's great to have my son. He's our oldest son, Ethan, with me this morning. And he's been on this trip with me. We're very blessed to have four sons, my wife, Natasha, and I. And he got to come around with me this trip. We've been to Egypt, Germany, and quite a number of cities in the States. But tomorrow we go home. So pray for us that the weather will cooperate, that all our flights, we have to fly through DC, that it would have no problems whatsoever. This morning, a message that I feel to share with you, and in a sense, I don't want to preach. I just want to, or teach. I'm actually more of a teacher than a preacher. I want to just talk with you. Is that okay? Can we just sort of engage with the scripture a little bit and think through some things today together? I'm not really great at being the mother bird that chews the food and you just open your mouth and spit it in and you don't have to chew it. I don't like that kind of thing. I want to give you some of the meat of the scripture today. Is that okay?
Yeah.
And for you to chew it for yourself. And I think the scripture is so amazingly transformative in its power, but it requires our engagement. You can't just sleep with the scriptures under your pillow and wake up the next day transformed. Wouldn't that be nice? You have to engage with it. And how many of you found, if you've been a child of the Lord for a period of time, the scripture is sometimes difficult to engage with? And I think that sometimes as preachers, we feel the temptation to, can I be horrible, dumb it down? To sort of simplify it, just so that we can, it's manageable. And that's good, and that's right at times to do that. But I'm sometimes concerned that we seem to underestimate our people's ability to process the scripture and to use it appropriately in their lives. So what I want to do is really take us to the scripture today and to think through the scripture a little bit. And the title of this message is The Power of Devotion. The Power of Devotion. Now, back home, as a family, we love to go camping. And when I say camping, I mean with tents and stretchers and, you know, inflatable mattresses. We have a favorite spot in our nation, which I think is the most beautiful part of the world. It's called the Garden Route. Down in the south coast of the Cape Province. And we love every year for about 3 weeks, we go camping in this specific place. And our campsite will be about from me to halfway through the seats, the ocean will be. So when I walk out of my tent, there's rocks and there's the ocean. And every day when I, as we call it, braai, do you know what braai is? That you'd call it barbecue, but we just do it a lot better than you do it. I must say, Texan barbecue has won me over, so I'm a fan. But every evening when we braai at our campsite, the dolphins would be hunting right in front of our. I'd be watching them, and there'd be a couple of whales in the background. It's come to South Africa. Just that's all I can say. And so we camp. So in my storeroom that I have at home, I have different containers that I keep the things in for camping. And there's some containers that are marked essential. Or I know, these are my essential containers. When we go camping, they have to go along. And then I've got other containers that are my extras. You know, sometimes you have two of one thing, two lights or two something. And when we have enough space, it's nice if these things can go with. But it's not a crisis if they don't. Now, it can happen that when you arrive at the campsite, you put the wrong box in. And you put the box in that is the extras and not the box with the essentials. How many of you know then you're in trouble? It's so important that we put the right things in the right boxes and that we respond according to the labels that things has on it. I think it's spiritually very true for us also. That we need to know which boxes to put things in. Even spiritually, there's different categories of things in our lives. There are essentials, and there are things that are not perhaps extras, but that are the outflow of the essential. And if we get those mixed up, we tend to not experience that which God has called us to experience. And that's a little bit what I want to talk with you about today. I want us to go to Acts 2, and it's Palm Sunday today, but I'm gonna look at Palm Sunday from the perspective of looking back from the church that is already now functioning and that is a result of what happened, Palm Sunday and everything that happened after that, the crucifixion, the resurrection. So we're going to take a little bit look at the result of what we are celebrating this week and next week. Acts 2 verse 42. This is such a familiar portion of scripture. You'll all know this. Acts 2 verse 42. I read from the New American Standard. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common, and they began selling their property and possessions, and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. How many of you read that portion of scripture before? When you read it, or even now as we read it, have you read it with a sense of longing? A sense of saying, wow. If we could just have the same experience. Have you read it like that? Has it evoked in you that sense of desire, that sense of man. That it's almost, it paints for us this picture of the perfect church. How many of you felt like that when you read that scripture? That's like, wow, that's the church in its essence, the perfect church. And so many times when we read these scriptures, and as preachers and pastors and theologians, you start dissecting and talking about this scripture from an angle of how can we get back to that? How can we today have the same experience as what these people had? Every one of our churches, we are consistently wrestling with these dynamics and saying, there's such treasures in you. I mean, they're adding day by day, that nobody had need, the miracles that were happening. All of us would long for these things and say, Lord, how can we have this as our experience today? How can the Abbey today walk in this same experience? Because we don't think that this is in Scripture just because it was supposed to be their experience. We think it's supposed to be our experience today also, that these dynamics are among us. Now, I think anybody of us that have spent any time with the scripture will recognize the key first part of that, of verse 42. They were continually devoting themselves. Devoting themselves. Devotion is a very, very powerful thing in our lives. The word devotion in the original language has a bent to it that is about consistency. When it says they devoted themselves, that wasn't just once or twice doing something. That means that they consistently did something that they believed to be right, and they kept at it. I think sometimes in our world today, we struggle with devotion. Devotion has become a very pragmatic thing. We show devotion to things because of the immediate results we think it'll give us. And if it doesn't give us the immediate results that we wanted, our devotion wanes. Have you recognized that in your own life? Every so often we go on a diet and we're devoted to eating better. But it generally lasts till about the 6th of January, and then, you know, my devotion for ice cream always exceeds my devotion for wanting to eat better. And it's one of my regrets on this trip so far. I haven't had Bluebell ice cream yet. And I don't know how. I'm going to go home and not have Bluebell. So this is faith without hints. Anybody want to? Okay. But devotion in our lives is what changes us. It's what you're devoted to that determines the quality of your life. Can I say that again? It's what you're devoted to that determines the quality of your life and of the experience of your life. These people were devoted. They had a devotion. Now, let's remember, Luke's writing this after the whole story was completed. So he's looking back at these believers and remembering the early days of the church. And remembering, and he's picking out what were some of the key stories as he's compiling his history of what happened with the early church. Some believe Paul wrote the book of Luke to help Paul in his defense in Rome. So he was building a case for Christianity as he was writing. And now he's remembering back the early days and he's writing. And as he looks back, he says, one of the key things that we had right from the beginning was devotion. The people were devoted. The church of the Lord Jesus will never impact the world if it's not for the devotion of its people. The church does not in and of itself have some magic power that you can just drop it in a location and it will change the area. The church is an activator of devotion. It is a place where people have to come to and buy into and become part of and play their part and take their role and put their shoulder to the wheel. And when they show that devotion, the transformative power of the gospel starts being displayed through the church. But it always requires devotion. And we also live in a cynical time. We live in times where people find it hard to be devoted, not merely because they want immediate results, but also because they're cynical. They've been disappointed so many times. They've seen so many great leaders fall. They've seen that things that they thought, you know, what it, they knew what it was, disappointed them because some other truth started arising. Have you ever found it difficult to even be devoted to a local church because you're cynical? Because you think that perhaps they're not quite doing with the money what they tell us they're doing. Perhaps the leaders aren't as loving as the show they put up on a Sunday. Perhaps everything is not quite what I seem. And we've all heard the stories. I remember a great lady from somewhere in the south of America once told me, she said, if a hypocrite stands between you and God, you are closer to the hypocrite than you are to God. Isn't that powerful? If a hypocrite gets between you and God, the hypocrite is closer to you than, and you are closer to the hypocrite than you are to God. And guess what? The hypocrite is closer to God than what you are. Hypocrisy is a terrible thing. Jesus struggled with it. And because of these disconnects and this incongruency we see, because we're people and we aspire to these things, and it's nowhere other than in the church do we feel the pain of disappointment as keen. Have you noticed that? It seems like, you know, whenever I have to go through times of, let's say I have to make staff adjustments, I mean, the pain you feel of that in the church is far more than what people feel it in a business organization. Because there's something of us, something we aspire to. But I want to encourage you today and just say this to you. You have to be devoted to something. Yeah. If you can stay safe and not devote yourself and not be disappointed and protect yourself from disappointment, but you'll achieve nothing. Because it is what you're devoted to that will determine the quality of your life. And if you're devoted to nothing, you may protect yourself, but you'll achieve nothing. You have to take the risk. You have to take the risk of being devoted. These guys had to take the risk of being devoted to the apostles. You have to take the risk. Because whoever your leaders are, Pastor Paul and Perry Ann, or whoever your situation is, whoever your leaders are, they're not perfect people. And you cannot say, I will give my devotion according to the measure of their perfection. You cannot do that. I wish I could do that. I wish I only had to be devoted to perfect leaders and perfect situations. But in all the places I've been, I've not found somebody worthy of my 100% devotion other than the Lord Jesus. But I had to give my devotion nonetheless. Nonetheless, I had to be devoted. So I want to stir devotion in you this morning. If this area is going to see the kingdom of God come in the way that you and I and every one of us dream of our areas to see the kingdom of God come, it'll only happen because of devoted people. Yeah. Yeah. Jesus said, go into all the world, preach the gospel, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. The whole book of Acts is the story of how that unfolded. And Jerusalem was impacted not by Jesus. Is that okay to say that? Jesus didn't change Jerusalem. When he left, there was 120 people. He said, it's better for you that I go. What changed Jerusalem? The power of the Holy Spirit coming upon and activating devoted people. Devoted people changed their city. And you and I sit here today because of the devotion of these people. Are you devoted to something? Or are you playing it safe? Are you afraid of being disappointed? Perhaps you have been disappointed. I want to pray for you today and say, that's real, man. We've all been there. I don't want to act like it's not real. And it's very hurtful. It's really problematic. But I want to pray that God will give you the grace and the strength to move beyond. To be wise. To be sensible. But to not keep your devotion. Devote yourself. Devote yourself. If you're part of this community and you don't feel you can devote yourself here, I want to say a dangerous thing. Then find the place where you can need to be where you can be devoted. It probably is here. It's just some things you have to work through. But your devotion, life's too short to live it half-baked. Jesus said, I will spit you out of my mouth if you're lukewarm. And the interpretation of that. We can't just play it safe. And I think I fear for the Western world particularly because we have made safety a high priority. We made our personal safety the highest priority. And it is a priority. It's a priority to God. He's our protector. But safety is not the highest priority. The kingdom's the highest priority. And if we want to play it safe all the time, the kingdom's going to suffer. So what were they devoted to? The scripture tells us. They were devoted to teaching. They were devoted to that which Jesus said. Remember when he gave the commission, he said, teaching them to observe all that I command you. These people recognized they needed to receive the truth of the kingdom. And therefore they needed to put themselves in positions where they could receive the truth, where they could be changed by the truth. And you and I need to show devotion to the teaching of the word. And can I say this to you with all the love in my heart, is that it's your responsibility to receive the teaching of the word. What we love to do is we put it on somebody else. We say, they must teach me the word. Now, I have a responsibility as a teacher, and I'm not running away from that. But you can only teach people that want to be taught. I think Winston Churchill once said it. He said, I love learning, it's being taught that I have a problem with. I love learning, but being taught is not so easy. Do you come to the scripture? Do you come to the kingdom of God with a hunger, a desire to know the truth? And if you don't know it, you will turn over rocks and keep searching till you find the truth. Or if it becomes difficult, do you just say, oh, well, whatever. If God wanted me to know that, he would have made it easier. Jesus said, don't cast your pearls before the swine. Seek with all of your heart. It's that devotion. The second thing they were devoted to is fellowship. They just loved being together. Two fellows in one ship. They just enjoyed having things in common. And there was a sense that grew among them of we need each other. In Africa, we have a saying, we call it Ubuntu. I cannot be if you aren't. It's impossible for me to be happy while you are sad. It speaks of that interconnectedness. And in the scripture, it's the same thing. Christianity is not an individualistic pursuit. Do you know that you cannot be a functioning, fruitful Christian on your own? It is impossible. Think of the fruit of the Spirit: love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness. Do you recognize that all of those are relational qualities? Leave me to myself, love, peace, patience, kindness. It's not such a problem. I can be pretty patient with myself because I know my motives. So if I get it wrong, it's okay. My motives were good. I can be patient with myself. I can be really kind. Put somebody else in the room with me, suddenly it becomes a little bit more challenging. God is stirring within us the hunger. And I think it is one of the major things across the world. Everywhere you bump into or walk into a people of faith, a Christian gathering, you will hear them talk about community. Because God is restoring to us the importance of fellowship. The next one is they broke bread together. Now, breaking bread, as we understand it, both meant they had communion, so that the elements, but they also shared meals together. They did life together. There was this sense of sharing with one another. And in both these concepts, fellowship and breaking bread, it had material overtones also. It's actually talks about in some areas that they shared their material things. They looked after one another. And then the last one is they prayed together. A community of faith needs to pray because it's always dependent on God's direction. It's not about what we need. We need to recognize that our faith communities is not about us, it's about Jesus. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said that a community, a spiritual community, is not a human ideal to be realized. In other words, it's not something you and I can achieve. It's impossible for the Abbey to have kingdom community on its own. No matter how much you love one another, no matter how much you like one another, no matter how much you have in common, you will not achieve kingdom community because it's not a human ideal to be realized. It is a spiritual reality that we get to be part of, Bonhoeffer said. It's what Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has among themselves. And they've invited us into that. But we cannot go there. We don't have what it takes. We don't have the relational capacity. We don't have the love in us to do kingdom community. except when the Holy Spirit comes upon us and He strengthens and empowers us and brings the agape love of God, the love that holds the Trinity together, the love that is the experience of the Trinity. God did not create mankind because He was lonely. He was perfect within Himself. He wanted to love. And He invites us into that. We shouldn't have relationship with God that is based on need purely. It should be based on our want for Him. He's not some necessity that we have in life, some accessory that makes life possible. He is life beginning to end. If we lose ourselves in Him, we find life. So these four things they had devotion to. And this led, their devotion, if we read the scripture, leads to this wonderful thing in Acts 2, verse 44 to 45. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common, and they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Wow! Wow! Wouldn't you love to be part of a church and not have any need? Wouldn't it be great if that was being able to be said? Let me make it for me. Of the churches I lead back home, I mean, it would be wonderful if it could be said that nobody in our congregation has need. Because everybody shared everything together. Wouldn't that be amazing? Have you ever wondered, how did we not maintain this? How is it that the book of Acts records these early Christians in their infancy? I mean, this is probably just in the first year or two after Jesus left. In the infancy of faith, right there in the beginning, in the purity of their faith, these people had this quality of experience. How did we lose it? I don't know if there's any churches across the world, growing, engaged, active churches, wrestling with the reality of this world, that today can say, no one among us has need. I can't say it of the churches I'm involved with. Can you say it of the Abbey? Is there people here that have need? How is it? How did we lose this? Is it something that we're supposed to still have today? Is it something we must go back to? Now, I want to read for you a very interesting scripture. Remember, this is the church in Jerusalem. No one had need among them. But read what Paul says in Romans 15, verse 25 and 26. But now, I am going to Jerusalem serving the saints. For Macedonia and Achaia have been pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. Do you see what's going on? Not even the church in Jerusalem could maintain the reality for very long. Droughts happened, persecution happened. Eventually, what Pastor Paul referred to earlier happened. And the church in Jerusalem, twice in the scripture, they needed offerings to be taken in the church outside of Jerusalem and to be sent to Jerusalem to help just feed the people in Jerusalem. So here in a short space of time, a couple of years, we move from no one had need among them to almost everybody in that community having need. What happened? What happened? I think that's a very important question. And I asked that question when I was studying this. I asked that myself. I said, okay. Because for so long, I realized I have gone under this idea that my church is supposed to get to that point where everything's perfect and everything's wonderful and no one has need. And every time a person in our community has some need and I can't meet it, I feel bad. Because we're not supposed to do that. We're supposed to, you know, and must I own property or must I sell my property? What must happen? And then you read Ananias and Sapphira and you get all freaked out because what are we supposed to do? And should we be communists? And socialism and all this stuff because nobody must have need. But now I read the Church of Jerusalem that had a different experience. They started there but didn't stay there for very long. Why? Why? Why did that happen? Because we have to remember, Jesus said, go therefore into all the world, preaching, witnessing, teaching them, baptizing people. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. The idea was never to build a perfect church in Jerusalem. Right. The idea was to reach the uttermost parts of the earth. Yeah. The whole book of Acts is this track, Jerusalem to Rome. Yeah. And all the problems that happened in between. The objective is not to be the perfect church, it's to bring the gospel to the world. Not that we're afraid of trying to be the perfect church. And I believe in trying to be the best church we can. Because if this community here doesn't have something that represents kingdom values as good as you can, then what do we have to tell them? Right. If the church can't get along with each other, how dare we tell people out there to come to us? Yeah. Yeah. Because we've got some better life experience than that we have, but we can't stand one another. If we can't get along with each other, if we don't have a quality of life that should actually make other people jealous in our communities and go, wow, we want what they have, what right do we have to preach? So I believe in building the church and making it as good as you can. But that's not the main objective only. That is a missional activity. When I shepherd people, when I go to visit people in hospital and pray for the people in our church and spend time with them, with their marriages, that is a missional activity. That is no less mission than going on a trip to, well, Africa. I can't say Africa, being from Africa. So going on a trip to the States to be a missionary to the Americans, you know. I'm just kidding. It's what you do here as a community is mission. Because you are earthing kingdom and making it visible here. Jesus prayed, let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And that's the main task of the church. The kingdom is bigger than the church, but the church is the chosen vehicle for God to make the kingdom touch down. And not be something that people dream of, but something people can touch, taste, see, and feel through you and me. Jesus said, they will know you by your great preaching, by your miracles, by your love for one another. When I love somebody else in my community of faith, I am making the kingdom real. Therefore, that's why Paul writes it. He says, first to the church, and then. Sometimes we want to run and love the world, but we don't want to bother with each other. Now, I'm not talking about being a little holy huddle and we're not concerned about anybody, but we must love each other radically. We must radically just give our lives to each other. Because from that, we create a reality where others can be brought into, or that you can take to others. As Jesus sent his disciples 2 by 2. Why did he send them 2 by 2? Because their greatest display of the kingdom, one of the things would be the people would watch the two of them. How they spoke and related to each other. They became a visible representation. Love this church. Love. Be devoted to one another so that the job can be done. So that the task can be fulfilled. That God's name will be glorified and be preached in every place. And every person will not only hear about Jesus, but have some frame of reference to say, wow, if that's what Jesus is like, tell me more. Because I see him. And that's our privilege. So the church in Jerusalem was never supposed to be this little perfect place. This monument that we could all go visit every now and then and say, oh, wow. Now, my wife was in Israel last year. I've never been. My wife's in Israel last year. And she loved some of the experiences. But she also came back and said, it's a dirty place, man. It's just not a nice place to visit, a lot of it. Because it wasn't supposed to be this holy place that we go and visit and feel, oh. Jesus was here. More than Jesus is here. Right here. Today. He's right in your life. Tomorrow when you go to work in the budget meeting where things are getting a little bit strained and tense, Jesus is there because you're there. You're the temple, aren't you? And that's the reality we have to live in and make real for ourselves. Not hold this little perfect picture. But get into the messiness of life and trust that which God deposited within us, the seed that he's given us. The kingdom in your life cannot grow while you hold on to it. It grows when you give it. That's why Jesus all the time spoke of the kingdom as a seed. The kingdom is like a seed. It's like a man who planted a seed. How many parables? Because the kingdom grows when you give it away. And so often we as believers, we become so afraid. I don't know enough. Man, if you know Jesus, you know enough. And you won't know more until you give what you've got. I'm not talking about knowing more because you've attended courses and seminars and have been taught a lot of fancy things and you know theoretically. I'm talking about doing. Doing the works of the kingdom. So what happened in the church of Jerusalem is God allowed that perfect place. Nobody had need. Miracles to be disrupted. He allowed it to break up. The apostles and a few stayed in Jerusalem. Everybody else fled for their lives. In Acts 8, after the stoning of Stephen. And the scripture tells us wherever they went, they multiplied the church. And I love the story of Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. I don't have time to spend on that, but have you studied the eunuch? This was a bizarre character. We cannot completely identify his race. He's an ambiguous character. And if you study him historically, it's not clear what race he was. He was from Ethiopia, but there's a good likelihood that he wasn't an Ethiopian himself. His race was debatable. His religion is debatable. Because he was a God-fearing man and showed interest, but he came from a different background. This is the hard one. His gender was debatable. We don't know. Was he a man? To what level? Because he was a eunuch. We don't know if he was born that way. He was probably made that way as a slave. He's standing. He was a very important man, but he was a slave at the same time. So he's this weird character. And God takes, the Spirit takes Philip away from a revival to meet this one man on a road and share with him the gospel. But do you know what? That was the first event where the gospel went to the uttermost parts of the earth. Ethiopia was literally called in those days the uttermost parts of the earth. And he was the first one that went with gospel knowledge. Because the gospel is powerful. And you and I carry it today in the same way. So if it wasn't supposed to be this perfect picture, and our job is not to get back to, and so often you'll hear people say, we must be the New Testament church. What does that mean? Does it mean that we must experience the same things as we read here? Is the expectation, therefore, on you and me today to sell our possessions and so to give it to the church leadership and to say, will you divide it all among us so that nobody has need among us? Is that what it means to be the New Testament church? Have you ever thought about that? Is that something you've never thought about? Is that supposed to be the quality standard for what it means to be the New Testament church? Now, I think we get a little bit confused sometimes when we put wrong things in the wrong boxes. When we don't understand where things belong. In our faith as believers, we must always remember, and I want to just use these two boxes, that there's something called roots. Roots. And I want to put the bigger box here for roots. And the smaller box is what I would call fruits. Put the smiley Amazon face on your side. So that we have roots in our faith and we have fruits. When you get confused between which things are roots and which things are fruits, you start getting the whole thing upside down. Right. Yeah. And I want to put before you today that I think in our communities of faith, sometimes we do that. We make the roots the fruits and the fruits the roots. Now those two are very important to understand and they can never be separated from one another because in the fruit is the new root. Now I don't want to get you on that, but you understand what I mean. The seed, the potential for new tree is in that. Jesus said you will know a person by their fruits. But fruit is the result of the roots. Have you seen an apple tree stand in an orchard and going, apples? Do they put stress and strain on themselves to produce apples? Do you walk past an apple tree and every now and then find peaches on the apple tree? And say, bad apple tree. You know you're supposed to be an apple tree. You must produce apples. Come on, just concentrate a little bit more. Just go. Just focus, man. No, we don't do that. Because in the word in the Greek is the word karpos. And the word karpos literally translated means a fruit, which is the word for fruit, is the product of the inherent energy of a living organism. So that which is inside produces fruit. So Jesus was basically saying that if we are rooted in Christ, we will see the fruits of it. But the issue, in a sense, is not about my fruits, it's about my roots. Because the roots take care of the fruits. And a very important thing to remember about roots is roots are permanent, fruits are seasonal. Roots are permanent, fruits are seasonal. Because of the devotion of the New Testament church, they were rooted in those four things. Teaching, the word, fellowship, breaking bread, and prayer. That was their root system, those four things. So if we had to take those four things out of that scripture, we put it in this box, the roots box. You okay? Do you agree with me? Does that sound logical to you? That's the root system. So what would be the fruits from that portion of scripture that we need to put in our fruit box? I'd love to have two-way conversation. It just doesn't help on a Sunday. But I would put to you that the things that we read, nobody, the miracles, right. Nobody had needs, that, all the stuff we read, that belongs in the fruit box.
Right.
Yeah. Do you agree with me?
Yeah. That's good.
Okay, if you don't, let me try and convince you. Anybody not agree? Somebody put up your hand just so that I convince you, can convince. Okay, thank you very much, Alyssa. Appreciate that. Why don't we... If I come down here, why don't we, when people get saved, tell them you must sell everything you have and give it to the poor? Do you do that at the Abbey? That may affect your church growth slightly. Why don't we do that? Why don't we teach people you have to sell everything? Because Jesus told a couple of people to do that, didn't he? Because that's not the root deal, that's a fruit thing. Let's think of the guy, the rich young ruler, comes to Jesus, says, what must I do to inherit the kingdom? You read the scripture, it's very interesting to me. Jesus says, one thing you lack, and then he tells him to do two things. One thing, and then he tells him two things you must do. One thing you lack, go sell everything you have, give it to the poor. One action. Second action, and follow me. What was the one thing he lacked? Was it to sell everything he had and give it to the poor? Or was it to follow Jesus? In order to inherit the kingdom. What was the one thing he lacked? Who's for follow Jesus? Okay. Who's for sell everything you have, give it to the poor? Okay, I'll meet you afterwards. Why did that young man, specifically Jesus, say that to him? Because he didn't say it to many other people. Because that was the thing standing in his way for doing the one thing, which was following Jesus. So it may be that in a time of your life, the seasonal fruit that is required is that you sell things and give it away. I've been through times like that. I've been through times, and I'll probably still go through times again, where the Lord will challenge me and say, you need to get rid of some of this because it's starting to get a hold of you. It's not the property we own that's our problem. It's the property that owns us that's the problem. And Jesus saw that this rich young man could not come into the kingdom because he was holding onto his property. So Jesus said, sell everything and give it to the poor. We don't perpetuate that in every church because we understand the root thing is your devotion to Christ. But the fruit, which is a permanent thing, you must be permanently rooted in Christ. The seasonal thing is the fruits of that season of your life. We will always bear fruit. I know we go through times of difficulty and sometimes we call it winter times, but can I tell you, there's never a day in your life where you won't bear fruit. You'll always bear fruit. But the seasons of the fruit will change. The magnitude, because Jesus said, if you bear fruit, I will prune you so that you can bear much more fruit. And can I tell you what is so important about fruit? If you read John 15, at the end of John 15, he says something, I'm probably misquoting it a little bit. He says something like, in your fruitfulness, your joy will be made complete. If you don't bear fruit, your joy disappears. Fruit produces joy in us. Have you ever led somebody to Jesus and felt that amazing joy that comes upon your life? That's the joy of fruitfulness. Or shared something with somebody. God says to you, the other day I was in a store. God says to me, I need you to buy these people's groceries for them. Now what's the first thing you do when God says that to you? Look at their cart. And you sort of sum it up. You do a quick scan in your mind. How much is this going to be? And they had quite a full cart. This was an old elderly couple. They had a full cart. And the Lord said to me, I need to pay for their groceries. And I'm like, let's pray about this again. If they had a basket and they were in the express checkout, no problem. But this was because sometimes that the Lord just, he'll do that. And when I did it and I paid for them, I had to convince them, this old elderly couple of them. I spoke to the lady, she was closest to me. I said, ma'am, I just feel like I want to pay for your groceries. She's like, no, you can't do that. So her husband hears now, he thinks something weird's going on. So he's like aggressively leaning on her, excuse me. So I say, sorry, sir, I don't want to bother you. I don't want to impose, but if you'll allow me, it'll be my privilege to pay for your groceries today. They're a retired couple. So they're like, no, we can't let you do that. And so I had to convince them and eventually pay for their groceries. But you know what? When I walked away, I realized God told me to do that more for my sake than for their sake. Because I needed at that point just to let go of a bit of things. It's what are you devoted to? Your devotion is your root system. What is the Abbey devoted to? Your devotion here must be the same as every other community of faith across the world. That's what ties us together. Our root system, if you go underground deep enough, we're all rooted to the same thing. Yeah. It's wonderful. I love the fact that I can travel in different parts of the world. Sometimes I'm with people I don't even understand their language, but I feel the connection because our root system is the same. We're all devoted to the same thing. If you're the living, active, breathing body of Christ, you're all devoted to the same things. Yeah. But will it look the same in every location? No, because fruit is seasonal according to the time and the place. Scripture says God ordained for you the time and place to live. God didn't want you to live in Africa. He wanted me to live in Africa. He wanted you to live here for your season to bear the fruit that you need to bear here. But your fruit is the product of your roots. So my challenge to you as I come to an end, my challenge to you this morning, my question, perhaps more than a challenge, is for you to individually think through. What is my devotion? How strong is my root system? Many years ago I was in London and they had a wind come up one evening. I didn't think it was a great deal, but it was quite a strong wind. And that next morning we read in the newspaper, 1 million trees in the city fell over that night. 1 million trees. Because in England it rains so much that the roots don't go deep into the ground. The roots stay on the surface. They don't need to penetrate deep to go look for where we come from, our trees, like it would be here, have deep root systems. Because they have to look for water most of the year. It's not on the surface available to them. So when a strong wind comes, the trees just, but they stand. How deep's your root system? How deep are you looking for the treasures of God? Or are you just on the surface, just using the water that comes to you? That's fine to begin with. If you're in early on, that's okay. But at some point, you have to turn your roots down and start digging and start digging and start getting through the difficulties and devote yourself. Devote yourself. At some point as a believer, you cannot just read the scripture devotionally. You cannot just go, okay, today, what's my scripture for the day? Or have the SMS and say, oh, I've done my scripture. That's fine. That's great. But at some point, you've got to go deeper than that. Because nothing will change your life like your direct devotion to the scripture. That's the power. That's the seed. Are you devoted to the teachings? Are you devoted to the gathering of the saints, to being a person open for relationships. Some of us in this room are extroverts. We love people. We want to be around people all day long. Some of us are introverts. Doesn't matter how your personality works out. You still have to have a devotion to people, to wanting to share your faith, to have community with others, to break your bread together, to dig into the realities of what it means to be a child of God in a community. You cannot just skip along the surface. At some point you have to dig in. And not just be a church visitor, a church attender, but a church liver. Not a liver. That's a terrible word. I shouldn't have said that. The word, never mind. I can try and spiritualize it now. That was just a terrible word. But you should be a church engager. Your home becomes the church. An extension of the church because you live it, your devotion. You've got to be a person that is devoted to prayer. In the New Testament church, they prayed both set prayers and spontaneous prayers. In other words, set prayers were often their community prayers. Now, we don't do that much, I don't know here, but we don't do that much, which is, I'm not saying we have to do that. The point is there's a togetherness in prayer and there's an individuality in prayer. When we devoted to those things, as we are showing our devotion to those realities, what will happen in us, fruits will start popping up naturally. You don't chase the fruit, you chase the root. And then the fruit comes. What are the fruits of your life? Now, if I could spend time with every one of you, we'll quickly identify the fruit that you are currently bearing. I want to encourage you in this. There's not one single person in this room that is not bearing fruit. Right now, you may not recognize it as such, but it's there. You have something that is attractive to others. Something that if you give it, it'll multiply. For this is the work of the fivefold ministry, to prepare the saints for their works of service, their fruit. So I encourage you today just in this. Make sure you root it. And let the fruit come. And then a beautiful thing happens. Is the fruit of your life starts becoming clear. And then you start being planted. You are planted in a bigger orchard. And a bigger fruit starts happening. And there's a community of fruit. And that's called a harvest. That's a harvest. Is when there's a community together that bears fruit. That rub off on each other. You know that a tree needs other trees. It cannot bear fruit on its own for long. Because eventually it'll have nothing that will cause it to be fruitful. And sometimes it'll become sick. But when it can cross-pollinate, there's something that stays healthy. God is one who has planted you. What are the roots that you have? What are the roots of the abbey? Show devotion and let the fruits grow. And the fruit will be beautiful. It will be sweet. It will change and transform an area. Not because you're perfect, but because you're devoted. Yeah. I want to pray with you. Can I ask just the worship guys, you can come up. Wow, I didn't even keep an eye on the time. I'm sorry about that. I went a little bit too long. Why don't you consider this morning just your devotion? And this is a very personal thing. And in a sense, I feel to not even ask you to raise your hand or do anything because this is not about somebody else. This is about you. Just ask the Lord, Lord, what's my devotion like currently? Am I devoted? Just ask the Lord. This is not a guilt place. But it's probably true that over a period of time, the Lord has been speaking to you. And perhaps in a moment like this, that can come to the surface more clearer for you. And all the Lord is saying is, if you recognize it, I will help you do it. More than help you, I'll make it possible for you. You guys can just play if you want to. So just take a moment. Just be before the Lord Jesus right now. If you need to close your eyes, you do that. And just say, Lord, my devotion. Personally to Jesus, to His Word. But also my devotion to the body of Christ. Help me, Lord. Lord, I just pray for this beautiful community of people. Thank you for the honor to be with them today. I just pray for them right now. I speak over them today, Lord, a release. A release of your Spirit. That a devotion can grow in them, Father, to a new level in Jesus' name. Every person's on their journey, and you're not expecting them to be at year 20 when they're only at year 5. You're just expecting them to be where they're supposed to be. To bear the fruit of that season. But I pray, Lord, just come right now. Stir something in our hearts. If there's a cynicism upon our lives, if there's a fear, a disappointment that withholds us from being devoted, I pray right now, Lord, that you would allow us to break through those things in Jesus' name. If you've been hurt in the church and it's withholding you, you need to ask the Lord, am I being cynical? What must I do, Lord? So often a big part of that is to forgive, just to forgive people. Don't let some person's failure withhold you from God's perfect plans. Come, Jesus. Come, Lord. Come, Lord Jesus. We want to ascend. We want to go up to the mountain of the Lord. Yeah, the kids are getting noisy. Their time's up. That's okay. Just allow the Lord to just release in your life. And I pray for you that as you continue on, if there's something valuable that I said, I pray that the Lord will remind you of that. And just let it be part of your journey and let it be part of your progress towards that which the Lord has for you. It's an honor to be with you today. We love you and we appreciate you and we love your pastors. And they're such great people. Thank you for this time. Lord bless you.
Hallelujah. You know, in America, because I live here, I'm more familiar with here than other locations. So it may be true other locations as well, but in America, in church, we have such a celebrity culture and such a technique. Everybody wants to know how you grew your church, not why. They don't want to know about the devotion. They want to know about the techniques. And so they'll hire in the next greatest flashy worship leader or preacher or figure out how to get it all working if you only have your service so many minutes. So it doesn't require really any devotion. You can gather a crowd. We've known people who have had openly admitted, pastors that had an adjustment and a change in their life, said that they grew their church to over 1,200 people before they realized they weren't even saved themselves. Because they knew the techniques of gathering a crowd. What we've heard today is the call of God in Scripture to truth and to a devoted life. It's what we planted the church with 30 years ago. It's those values that have brought us, sustained us, and will carry us forward. It's those values that have raised our kids with a hunger for God. That hopefully then, and I believe that they do, know the difference. You train tellers at the bank to know counterfeit, not by handling counterfeit money, but by handling true money so that they know it, so they'll recognize a counterfeit when it comes. And it's that kind of a devoted life. Thank you, Pastor Louis, just for calling us back to truth and back to the call and the purpose and the mission of true church and for our lives to be a follower of Jesus. Amen. Tremendous values. Let's stand together. We're going to give you an opportunity to sow and to give into Pastor Louis' ministry, Pastor Louis and Natasha, and bless them. We know Scripture as well talks about honoring the gift and honor those that the Lord sends. So it's more important that we honor than meet their need. They have need in travel, but that's really not on us. What's on us is to honor the gift and honor the word that God sent to us today. And we do that financially. We do that by giving and sowing. That's an expression of honor. And so we want to do that this morning. We're going to give you an opportunity to do that right now. Mary Ann, did you do that? Yeah. We want to give Pastor Louis Natasha, a special gift.
So I know what it's like to travel internationally, and I went to a craft fair in South Africa and had to get that home in my suitcase, what I bought. So I almost hate to do this to you, but I felt when we remodeled, a lot of the things that used to be here ended up at my house, decorations, because we really wanted out with the old and in with the new. But recently, you guys know what we call that over there? Who knows what we call the children's wing? The treasure wing. Thank you. And so when we launched it, because we believe people are treasures. People are treasures. And so I bought these treasure chests. So see, it opens and everything. And I just thought they were beautiful. And I happen to know Louis's wife, Natasha, and that looks like her. But I just felt impressed. They've been on my table since we remodeled at my house, and there are two. And I just felt impressed today to just bring that. And I know it's a small thing, but it really, really represented the fact that kingdom treasure is each other. And so we wanted to sow that into your life. I'm so sorry. I feel like Ethan can fit it in his suitcase. I did really feel like that, you know, just as a metaphor for the fact that we want to fill that with monetary treasure, right? So something visual, something colorful, something that says the Abbey treasure, you have a deposit, we have a deposit of you, and we thank you for that. But then to just rally all of us as we give in this offering, you're sowing into the treasure that is each other. So that's a part of the Abbey.
Amen. Amen. So we honor each other with gifts. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So let's pray together, and then we're going to give you opportunity to give. Yeah, you can. We'll put that on the stage, and you can put your gift in the treasure box for them. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, for truth that is brought to our life, challenges us, shapes us, transforms us, and releases your fruit in our life. Father, we bless Pastor Louis and Natasha in Pretoria. We bless their family and Ethan and his brothers, Lord, and everything that they set their hands to do as they serve your kingdom in Pretoria and as we work together around the world. Lord, I release your presence and your just the fragrance of your anointing across every household and every individual in this place, Lord, that as they go forth this week, that they will carry that fragrance of the good news of Jesus to every person that they meet and everywhere they go. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, you're welcome to bring your offering to the front. We have Glory Team, those that will pray for people. They'll make their way to the front. If you'd like personal prayer, they'll pray with you today. If you're a first-time guest with us today, we would love to meet you face-to-face. We're going to slip out to our dining room to my left and your right, and we would love to give you a gift for being with us today. God bless you. It's great to have Teen Challenge guys with us today. God bless you guys. We love you. You have a wonderful week.